Thank you for joining AutoNetwork Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and this is 2016, and this is our first show for 2016. And when I say our, I mean the great-looking and very, very, very knowledgeable group of automotive journalists located in the panel below. And as we always do, I'll have them to introduce themselves and talk a little bit about what they're doing, and then we'll go back and we'll get you up to date as to what's happening in the news, what those few things that happened in 2015, what's going on currently in 2016, and keep you abreast of what we're going to be doing for the future, for the balance of 2016 shows. Right now, this is show number 95. Hopefully we'll hit 100 with no problem, and that should be a big blast and bash for everybody. Hopefully we can try and get 100 people to sit in. That'd be great, wouldn't it, have 100 people for the 100th show? But let's have the panelists introduce themselves, starting with Russ.
Merry New Year. Coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina. I'm Russ Heaps. I have been covering the automotive industry, car reviews, and the industry itself for over 25 years in newspapers and magazines, and as well as .com sites. I also run a little website called GreenvilleInsider.com, which is a deeper dive into Greenville. Anything you want to know about Greenville, South Carolina, we got it.
Ron.
Hi, Ron Moorhead, coming from Northern California, and I, like Russ, have been in the auto industry a long time. I work for people like Motor Trend, Car and Driver, Popular Mechanics, and a number of websites. So look at what we're doing. Do a little Google search on each one of the panelists, and you'll be amazed at the coverage that we have. Thank you.
Valerie.
Hello, everyone. Hi, Roosevelt. Glad to be here for the first show in 2016. I'm coming to you from sunny but crisp Austin, Texas. I'm the owner and founder of Latino Traffic Report, a blog that I launched last year, and the upcoming Chicago Auto Show will be the one-year anniversary of my site. It is focused on the Latino automotive consumer, the multi-generational consumer, meaning it's in English. And I'm happy to be here again, as I said, and looking forward to our conversation.
Frank.
Hey, it's Frank Washington. I'm based here in Detroit. I do a website called AboutThatCar.com. Right now, we're getting ready for the auto show. Press week is next week. And for the uninitiated, that means automotive press, as well as executives from the auto companies, dealers, as well as suppliers. We'll be here looking at the wares, and I forgot to mention that in Detroit, it is a balmy 42 degrees, maybe even more.
Wow, you're warmer than it is here in Charlotte.
Yes.
Linda.
Hi, I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from the beautiful Blue Ridge Mountains of North Carolina. I've been in this business as long as just about all of the folks on this panel. Started out racing cars, that evolved into writing about cars with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and then ended up writing for a lot of major publications, including Car and Driver, Better Homes and Garden, even a couple articles in Essence. And now I produce a website. It's called sharpdriver.com, and if you want to know more about me or if you want to know about cars, I invite you to check it out. And I'm looking forward to a lively discussion with a really great group of people today.
Well, you know, if you look at the number of panelists we have right now on the show and the years of experience, if you combine all of our years of experience, I think you come out close to 150 years right here. And only one of us look like they're that old, but I won't say who it is.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, but why did you fess up? See, I wasn't going to call your name. But that's a lot of years of a lot of exposure, a lot of travel, a lot of consumers looking at or reading our car reviews and what we think about the industry. So you have all in one place. You have quite a bit of knowledge. So we would love to... Oh, did I skip you, Greg?
I was just about to mention, we hadn't heard.
I can't even count anymore. Oh, I'm sorry, Greg. Valerie sent me a little chat message. Greg, I apologize. What's happening? Go ahead, Greg.
In the words of my former host a couple of weeks ago, ni hao. I'm Greg Morrison, executive producer and owner of Bumper to Bumper TV in Atlanta, Georgia, coming to you from our subterranean offices here. This is going to be a fun year. As you see, it's already a silly discussion with some great folks. I, like Frank, am getting ready for the Detroit Auto Show. Got my walking shoes on, got my stick with me to fight off the idiots, and we're going to have some fun to talk about cars this year, and there's some interesting developments in the industry this week that we should be aware of coming out of CES.
Yeah, I'm just, I'm not used to having all of you on at the same time. Normally, it's about three of us, and I can remember three, but as you can see, I can't go beyond five. Apologize for that, Greg. But one of the things that Ron Moorhead suggested that I do, and he mentioned that around the end of last year, 2015, and it's something that I thought was interesting. And what it is talk a little bit about what you are currently driving this week, meaning the panelists, without giving up all the information that you're going to put in your car review of that particular automobile. So we're going to start with Greg, if he has a car this week, say what it is and maybe a couple of things you like about it or don't like.
Well, I just turned in a Scion IA. And it's a fun urban car, but let's face it, folks, it's a Mazda. There are some good things I do like about it in terms of size and maneuverability. Some things I don't like about it in terms of interior space, especially if you're in the back seat. But we're going to post that up in about 2 weeks on Bumper to Bumper TV, and you'll get a chance to get our take. This was a deeper dive into the Scion IA. We had a fast look at it in Philly. This is a chance to really say what works and what doesn't.
Great. Ron?
Well, this week I'm driving a 2016 Honda Accord, and it is a typical Honda. Drives well, is comfortable. Again, more and more vehicles are going to CVT transmissions, and I don't like them. This is like driving a motorboat without my fishing gear. Other than that, Honda makes a great product. The one thing I will say is, they just redesigned their Civic, and it's so much nicer looking now. But
Frank,
I'm driving the Accord. Thanks.
Right.
Oh, okay. I'm driving a 2016 Cadillac ATS-V.
Ooh.
Basically, it's kind of like a bullet on wheels. You know, quite frankly, it's a twin turbocharged V6, makes 464 horsepower and 445 foot-pounds of torque, and it's a six-speed manual. The only downside, if there is one, is that it's rear-wheel drive, but I am on dry pavement, so it's a lot of fun.
Linda?
I am currently driving a 2016 Infiniti QX50, and it is technically a crossover, but unlike most crossovers, it seemed to be a combination between an SUV and a sedan. This is more like a crossover that thinks it's a sports car. Infiniti has really raised the bar on their interiors, and this is another glowing example of the luxury interiors that they're putting in their products. It's a fun car to drive. If I had any criticism at all of it, and it's a personal problem, it has a very sloped windshield, and I'm long-waisted, and every time I get in and out of it, I sort of whack my head, but it's a small price to pay for the very precise steering, and Ron won't like that it has a CVT, and surprisingly, it does not have paddle shifters, but because I'm not a fan of paddle shifters, because I think that computer is much smarter than I am. I never use paddle shifters. And I think Infiniti, Nissan make the best CVTs in the market. So I have no complaints about the gearbox, and it's very peppy, and it's a great-looking car, although I'm trying to figure out why every time I look at it, I think of a Porsche Pan America. I don't know what it is, but every time I walk up to that car, that's what I think of, but it is an Infiniti. and it's priced right. So,
Russ,
I currently have a Kia Sedona SXL, which is Kia's minivan, and unlike a lot of people, I'm really a big fan of minivans, and I like them. I like them for their utility. I like them for their space. I like them for their convenience, their utility. This one is loaded up, as are a lot of the vehicles that we get. It's got the power sliding side doors, the power operated rear hatch. So it's, I mean, there's nothing not to like. It's a terrific minivan. The only, my one caveat, if I was king of the world for a day and could wave my magic wand, I would have second row seats that fold flat on the floor. The third row does, the second row doesn't. And I think in today's market, you kind of need that. But anyway, it retails for about $44,000 with all these gewgaws and other goodies on it.
Valerie.
Well, we have a match. Russ, I too have been driving the Sedona, and I have had it. I have a 6-month long term on it, so I still have 2 more months actually left. And when you have a long term loan, it's really a special opportunity to really get to know these vehicles and put them through their just day to day workout. And me and this little Sedona, or the little Sedona and I, have been through a lot. it was broken into, and then recently I had a temporary stint as a holiday carrier for the U.S. Postal Service. I didn't use the Sedona, but maybe once. Did get a little test of its cargo capacity. So it's been a great vehicle. I like Russ, find it hard to criticize much about it because it is so elegant. I think that's what really impressed me initially. But now that I've had it for a little while, I have noticed that the navigation doesn't show traffic. Congestion. It shows you the map, but it doesn't have that, which is odd. Maybe something I can look into in a program. But right now, I hadn't seen that, so that's something I think they would need to be updated on it. But otherwise, I am definitely enjoying the 2015 Kia Sedona.
Well, my drive for last week really is the first thoughts car of the day, so I won't tell you anything about it until that point in time in the show, which is normally right before we go away. Let's talk a little bit about what's happening in the news. One of the big things, Mary Barra, want to congratulate her. She was appointed the chairman of General Motors, and that should be very, very interesting. She holds two of the top positions now and in General Motors, and from what I understand, she actually spoke at CES and introduced the Bolt EV, which for the amount of time that she gave it in the presentation, it's going to be a very, very critical and important car for General Motors. What do you guys think about Mary Barra in her new position? And we'll go right into CES as to what's happening out there in the consumer electronics industry.
I think it's great. She's a smart lady. There's no doubt about it. And she's doing some good things at GM.
I think that with her ascension to chairman of General Motors, it has basically cemented her position as, yes, I am running this operation, and it's not going to be the typical good old boys type of operation that we've come to expect. She has quietly consolidated her power over the years, and now it's her chance to really turn the Titanic in a different direction with the Bolt and her push for these kinds of vehicles and their recent agreement with Lyft. It shows that General Motors is changing, and she's apparently the one who's going to at least lead it for a while. I wish her nothing but the best, but as we all know, when you're in the upper echelons of the auto industry, it's literally swimming with the sharks on a daily basis.
I, for one, am very pleased to see a woman in charge. I can remember 20-something years ago having a fellow journalist say to me, well, you're just lucky to be a woman because it's a good time to be a woman in the auto industry, which basically meant, well, I don't think you belong here at all. So obviously Mary Barra has overcome those shortcomings, and I'm very proud to see that she has ascended to these high and lofty positions. As far as the Volt is concerned, I understand that it is a major focus for General Motors. But I think probably the biggest challenge that vehicle is going to face right now is today they said crude oil was at $33 a barrel. It's hard to get people to spend the money for a electric vehicle or, you know, or a vehicle like the Bolt when they can buy a much less expensive gasoline vehicle when gas is so inexpensive.
Well, I think the price point is going to help the Bolt. I think it's somewhere around 30 or maybe a little less than 30,000. So that's that sets them apart definitely from a Tesla, for instance, even though Elon Musk said he welcomes a car like the Volt in the marketplace. So.
Well, if they can, if I'm sorry, Linda, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, but if your focus when you buy a vehicle is fuel economy, you're probably a value shopper. You know, you're probably looking at affordability. If you're buying a $90,000 Infiniti QX80, you know, you don't care about fuel economy. But if your number one concern is fuel economy, you're probably looking at more, you know, in the price range of below $20,000, because, you know, that's all you can muster up to come up with a new vehicle, and then the fuel economy is important. So while I realize that the average or the median transaction price of new cars these days is well over $30,000, more like $35,000, For the financially challenged buyer who would really appreciate this increase in fuel economy, it might be a hard thing to swallow. Go ahead, Russ.
The only thing I was going to say about the Bolt is if what I have heard in the last couple of days about it, if indeed it does have a 200-mile range, and if indeed you can get it back up to an 80% charge from zero in an hour, that's a game changer. I mean, that's a lot of my criticisms over the year about electric is the short range and the length of time it takes to recharge the things. If this will really do those two things, that's a game changer, and for $30,000.
One of the things that you want to consider that I saw recently when I was in China was there's technology out there where you can swap out the main battery in a car now in 3.5 minutes. So I see this as a perfect fleet vehicle that, say, taxi services or Lyft, since General Motors is going all in with that, could use as a fleet vehicle. You just basically drive into the garage. I saw the technology in Beijing. You just pull up on the specially designed scissor jack. It jacks the car up, disconnects the battery, pulls it out, puts another one in, locks it in place, and 3.5 minutes flat. So if General Motors gets access to this kind of technology from Beijing Electric Motors, you know, the Bolt all of a sudden becomes a very usable urban vehicle, especially for taxis and city government fleets.
I'm just going to chime in and say anytime we can continue to move that envelope further when we're talking about lowering emissions and moving away from conventional fuel source vehicles, to me that's always a good thing. So like Russ has said, this technology is just improving on what's gone before it. So now we have further a longer range, which is great, which will get rid of some of the concern folks have of switching over to electric. But like Linda says, when you have gasoline so affordable right now, it may be hard, but I still think that there are folks that just want to do the right thing, that don't deny global warming, that really do want to have a vehicle that gets us away from fossil fuels. So any kind of advances to me, that's a win-win.
Well, I agree with you completely, Valerie, on, you know, anything that will get us away from fossil fuels is an excellent thing. I just think it's going to be a challenge for the people that really need this kind of vehicle.
Right.
I think the Bolt is going to have the same issue as plug-in hybrids and true electrical vehicles, and that's people worrying about where can I get my car charged and actually knowing where the closest charging station is. So I don't know whether the Bolt has on their nav system where it shows you the closest charging station or not. So that would be interested in knowing if it has that kind of capability. But moving right along, talking about what's happening in CES, a lot of manufacturers are looking for new technologies and are offering some of their own technologies because they don't want the technology companies to kind of take over the auto industry. And a few months ago we were talking about technology in cars, and there was a some research that was done that's saying most people don't want all of the technology that's currently in cars, nor do they use most of it. And I'm interested in knowing, does that mean now with what's happening at CES that the car companies are feeling that that's not correct, or that they're going to shove these new technologies, especially what's happening with autonomous cars and some of the features that you'll have on an autonomous car, are now going to be introduced in some of the cars that you can purchase today. So do the car companies know something that we don't know, or are they going to just push these technologies onto the consumer?
Well, car companies are really trying to sell cars to the millennials who are tied to iPhones and smart devices. And I saw a post today from a friend of mine who was at CES, and basically she says, a car is nothing but a rolling appliance now. It's a telephone or a smartphone with wheels. And they're trying to get to those folks because they're going to be the biggest group of buyers in the next 2 to 3 to 5 years.
They're also going to be the worst drivers in decades. But I think the car manufacturers are also looking at, they want to make sure to hang on to everything as far as the auto industry and being able to give the buyer what they want and not let Google and those other companies come in and circumvent what they're doing. I've heard that a few times.
Anybody else?
We all know that I'm the Neanderthal when it comes to technology. You know, it's well been documented on this show. But I time and time again meet people that say, you know, I'd like that car, but I really don't want to pay the extra money for all that stuff I'm never going to use. And, you know, I wonder if this is, again, a bit of a generational thing that, you know, you've got younger engineers and younger people that are making a lot of decisions, and they don't, you know, they look at this from the perspective of their point of view. They may not look at it from the perspective of all of their buyers' points of view. And we've also talked about many times on this show how younger people are more interested in getting the latest iPhone or the latest computer, or, you know, cars are not high on their list, as is exemplified by the fact that they're into these, you know, sharing things with automobiles. I mean, I don't know where the love affair with the automobile went, but apparently it left the city, you know, and that breaks my heart.
Well, there's been some recent research that kind of contradicts what some previous research was saying about millennials. Millennials now, especially the millennials in the upper age group of the millennials, are into buying cars. They are very cost conscious when they're looking to buy an automobile, but they are starting to buy more cars. And it's going to be interesting to see, like right now GM invested something like $500 million into Lyft, which is a ride sharing program. And even I think Mary Barra was talking about the Bolt as being a ride sharing car, not something that necessarily that people purchase to own anymore. So I think the manufacturers are looking at the product now. They pretty much accepted the fact that ride sharing is going to be here forever. And they're looking at it almost like the rental car fleets. You know, you're selling these cars to these ride sharing programs, and you have more of your product on the street, and you hope that people that can drive them will end up at some point in time buying them. But going back to the millennials and the technology, they use a lot of technology because they were pretty much grew up on technology, but they are buying more product. They are participating in like the Ubers and the Lyfts and the other ride sharing programs out there. But back to my initial question about the technology and whether the car companies are going to push this on the consumer, or are consumers literally asking for this? I haven't seen any of the packages anymore like you used to see on cars, where you can get a package with this in it and this and this, and it doesn't include this. Right now, I think the packages that I have seen are on the high end, like the cars that we get on a weekly basis to drive. So what do you guys think?
Yes. You know, they're going to push the technology on consumers. there's not a technology that I know of in my years of covering the industry that wasn't pushed on the consumers. You know, and I go back to the time when a multi-disc CD player was a big deal. You know, I remember heated seats was a big deal. I don't recall any movement on the part of consumers to say, gee, we want heated seats. We want CD players. So, yes, you know, it's going to be pushed on consumers. I think part of it is that it's kind of like, you know, and I don't gamble, but if you're covering the table, you put a little, you know, you put a little money on everything. Much like auto companies advertised on the internet before they even knew what they were doing, before they even knew whether the internet was successful. I don't know that they still don't know, you know, just how successful it is. And so I think what they're doing is they're covering all aspects of their bet because they, as someone pointed out, they don't want someone else coming in getting a bite of their apple.
Well, gosh, Frank, I was just thinking the big invention that I can think of in a vehicle was an 8-track.
Right.
Whoa, Charger, whoa.
I was going to go back to FM radios.
You're backing up too far there, Charger.
if you remember, we went through a year or so of watching Lee Iacocca do his own commercials selling America on airbags. Chrysler decided they were going to put airbags in all their vehicles. They weren't required to do it. You know, nobody cared about airbags, but they did it, and he got on TV for a year and sold America on airbags, and eventually, you know, now every vehicle made has an airbag. And it's, you know, I think it's kind of the same thing. They're going to do it and hope that the consumers catch up.
I think it must be just a thing of you throw enough stuff against the wall, some of the stuff sticks, some of it doesn't. And they're hoping that more sticks than not, you know, so.
Well, you remember now, when a consumer is rating an automobile, and a lot of incentives now from the manufacturers to the car company, well, from the manufacturers down to the dealers is based on customer service. The number one issue, whether a consumer is satisfied with a car or not, is the technology. So if you're dumping more technology in these cars, you're going to have more people that don't understand the technology. I don't think that their consumer ratings are going to go up. I think they're going to take the opposite direction. They're going to start going down. And it's going to start costing dealers a lot of money. Give an example. I had a comment on one of my walk-arounds of the Sonata, and this guy was asking me, did it have a CD player? And I said, yes, it did have a CD player. He said, well, I talked to the salesperson, and he said it doesn't have a CD player. You know, again, it depends on the equipment that's in that particular car, but this car had a CD player. If you go to the website for the manufacturer for the Sonata, it lists the CD player in their multi-entertainment system. But here you had a guy who went back to the salesperson and he couldn't even tell him where the CD player was, which is, that's basic.
Well, you know, remember, to most salesmen, a CD player is like an 8-track.
Yeah.
You know,
but I was in a car a couple of weeks ago and it had a CD player and it wasn't easily recognized as a slot for a CD player, but I happened to hit an icon and a CD came out of it, which I said, whoa, this is nice. But something as basic as CD players, getting the salespeople to explain that to a customer, and now you're dumping all this other technology on top of that.
What I was surprised at was that you still have low-tech that is considered an option. I was writing up a story on the Dart, and I didn't realize that an air conditioner is not standard equipment. How could that happen in this day and age? I mean, and they were making a big deal about how they've lowered the price on having to add that air conditioner, and it comes with a couple other bits of technology
if you want,
on
you want the package, fourth wheel and stuff like that.
Yeah, so imagine that. So you still have to pay extra for an air conditioner.
Well, you know, on the other hand, if Toyota recently, when they rolled out their new IM and IA, there's no satellite radio option for that vehicle. You know, their argument is that the millennials that they're appealing to are more interested in streaming music off of their smartphones, so they just made it easier for you to Bluetooth it in and not add the extra 3 pounds in weight for the satellite radio. So, I mean, it depends on who you're talking to. You know, Toyota also had a call the other day talking about their sales numbers, and one of the things they're pointing out is that millennials have eclipsed baby boomers as far as determining who is really buying cars, and that they admit that they're going after the millennials hard and fast because they have become, and in the next year or so will become the dominant force in the automotive industry in terms of sales.
You know, I never missed satellite radio until it got turned off since I've had the Sedona so long. The subscription lapsed.
So I'll tell you, satellite radio. Satellite radio makes a big difference to me.
You do get spoiled to it really quickly. That's a fact.
You know, continuing with what's happening at CES, a lot of the technology people out there are introducing their products and services to improve the performance of cars from a safety standpoint. And some of the technologies that they're introducing, even the manufacturers, you'll be able to literally have some of that in your car by the end of 2016, no later than 2017. And all of these new technologies are moving towards the autonomous car. And one of the things that I saw very interesting was that Ford has a contest going for the F-150. And what Ford is doing, when you get an F-150, or what they would like for you to do when you get an F-150, you will have a drone that comes with it. And what they're looking to do is, a lot of F-150s are, you know, used in construction sites and when disasters occur. So they're saying, okay, I can drive the F-150 up to a certain point. Now I can launch the drone to see what's ahead of me, and if it's a disaster, what's going on. I can't get the truck there. And they're posting something like a $100,000 prize for a developer that can come up with the best technology to be used with the F-150 and that drone. Can you write some programs, anybody? can you code?
Let me talk to my granddaughter about that. She codes.
Well, I have to say, my first impression when you said they were going to have a drone, I thought, well, that's silly. But then when you pointed out that, okay, if you're in a bad situation, you don't know what the road ahead is, you know, that actually sort of makes sense. I have to admit that.
I can't hear.
Go ahead, Ron.
A bunch of firefighters going, I'm going to shoot that sucker down if it comes over here.
I just can't. I can't imagine how you would. You know, it's. I can see applications for it, and I can see somebody, you know, maybe actually wanting it as an option, an extra cost option, but you know, why not? If you need a drone, why not just buy a flipping drone? Why would you need one that came with your car or your truck? I'm not sure what that application would be that would be different than just buying your own drone.
A couple of marketing people wanted to get drones through Ford, I think.
Well, one of the things that they were saying was that the drone would be linked into the systems in the F-150. So I would imagine if you were in an area like with Ron, with fire service, and you want to see where the fire was moving, literally from a drone, you could see it on the screen, on the nav or entertainment screen that's in the F-150. So you don't have to go out and try and get a separate screen. So all of the information feedback would be back into that F-150.
Isn't this taking distracted driving to a whole another level?
I had that on my list of things to mention, Valerie. And since you mentioned that, let's get right into it. It's taken it beyond a new level.
The drone is not operable when the vehicle is in drive. That's what I understood.
That may be true. I'm not sure. I hope that is the situation.
It needs to be true. I really like
but
that.
I just saw a piece. Somebody did a piece on CES, and they were showing these drones that somebody was featuring there that will follow you around. You don't have to control them.
Right.
They home in, I guess, on your smartphone, and you walk around, and they fly over you and just keep pace with you. So
okay. Why would you want to do that?
I have no clue.
Let's say you're test driving one of the cars that we drive every week, and you want an overhead shot while you're driving down the road. Perfect example.
You could be a one man operation,
huh?
Is Al the one promoting this deal?
Probably.
I hate to say it, folks, but it sounds like a Kardashian camera.
That was a good one, Greg.
But did you see the drone that's a one man? It's literally, it will fly a person. It's controlled by your smartphone, and you can literally sit in it, and you program where you want to go from point A to point B. It will take off and fly you there. It costs a little over $300,000. But the kicker is, it only flies for 24 minutes before the battery runs out.
I'll let one of you guys test fly this thing, and we'll see how it turns out.
But you're talking about the concern of a Bolt EV running out of battery.
Yeah, one of the things that we're not talking about is the FAA is now requiring every drone purchaser to register their drone. And what they found was they had more than 216,000 drones registered in a 30-day period.
Yeah.
Now, I had this vision in my mind of a bunch of trucks with drones attached to them parked on the side of the road, you know, while people were too busy looking at the screen and creating a traffic jam in the sky, as well as on the shoulder.
Yeah. It's like a swarm of locusts.
Yeah.
Well, back to Valerie's point about driver distraction, what do you think that's coming on the market right now in terms of technology, other than the old stuff that we've been talking about? What's some of the new stuff that you think that's going to be in the car that's going to really create driver distraction?
Volkswagen's gesture motion technology. Volkswagen at CES took the wraps off of what is basically a series of technologies in the cars that will be responding to your gestures. So, say you're talking to somebody in the car and you're pointing something out to them, well, the car may misinterpret that and do something else like drive off the road or park.
I hope they address that.
Just saying.
Greg, can you tell me what in the world you would need anything like that for?
Why would you have your hands on the wheel? Just talk.
I mean, why would you need something that reads your gestures? It's you know, unless it's the panic in your face when you're about to hit something. I mean,
I say you can't. You can't talk.
Think about the road rage situations when you want to provide that certain middle finger gesture to the other driver.
But Greg, going back to what you just mentioned, what are the gestures controlling?
The gesture supposedly will control radio, it will control turn signals, and like certain like wiper functions initially. I haven't had a chance to really dive deep into what Volkswagen is talking about, but it just strikes me that a gesture that you may be trying to do something else, like reach over, grab something in the seat, or grab your soda or water bottle that's falling over, may have the car do something that you don't want it to do, which you think about it. The last thing you want is the radio going full blast because you're reaching for a water bottle and scaring the bejesus out of you.
Are we really that lazy that we can't turn on the turn signals and we can't change the channel on the radio? And, you know, it's just mind-boggling that it's like, you know, we're all couch potatoes anyway, and they're making us more couch potatoes. I mean, if that's the only exercise you get, at least it's something, changing the radio station or activating the turn signal. I mean, of course, the ultimate, you know, laziness is, I don't want to drive the car, just let me sit in the back seat and take me there. So
I have to go back to Jay Leno when he had his show on television, and I loved it when people would come up with these new ideas to accommodate fat people or people in America getting fatter. And he was talking about back then the widening of the airline seat And he was saying, right, you know, why do we have to make the seats bigger? You just get people to lose their fat 80s instead of making things bigger to fit us. Why don't we do some things to reduce, you know, to reduce our own weight? But what, you know, talking about the gesture situation. Linda didn't turn her mic off. But talking about the gesture situation.
I'm coming.
What did they think about keeping both hands on the steering wheel?
I haven't the foggiest idea. It was just a new technology that literally just got unveiled. I want to learn more about it. But what I find interesting is you've got that. You've got Lexus talking about some new technology. In fact, Toyota and Ford talking about sharing technology for some of their smartphone applications and cars. It's already an incestuous business, and now this is going to make things relatively crazier. The idea of a camera, a drone that can follow you around, the other stuff that's coming out of CES, you know, this is where I'm saying, hey, let's tap the brakes on some of this for a minute until we really figure out how it works.
And I'll take it to the low-tech again. I'm sorry, Russ, but I'll just take it low-tech again and say, I just like some knobs on my radio controls. And like Linda was talking about, I think some young folks are just looking at form over function. And I was in the Honda. We were talking about Honda, Ron, earlier. And they have gotten rid of the knobs. And when you have to kind of look over, and that to me is distracting, to have to keep punching the scan button to get to your radios and do all that. So it can be very advanced like drones, or can it just be simple low-tech things like just put some knobs on the radio controls? Thank you.
You know what's also interesting? There's been a couple. Sorry, Russ. One real quick thing. Distracted driving, I know. Talking on your telephone, even if it's hands-free, is distracted driving.
There's right.
been two studies come out that have said that. Yeah. Go ahead, Russ. I'm sorry. I'll give you the floor.
I was just going to say, and you know, this is important stuff, because if I had my wish list, what they would be coming out with are glasses that you put on and you would be virtual driving. So while you're driving, you would be virtual driving. I think that's my suggestion.
And, that's a joke, right?
Well, I guess not.
I can see you virtual driving, and you hit something, and a new program comes up, and you're driving off a cliff.
There you go.
With a reset button.
Yeah. No, I drive a lot with Google Glass, and I have prescription frames for my Google Glass, so, you know, I'm legal. I can they are prescription frames, just like my regular glasses that I have on now. And even driving with Google Glass, where I can see normally, just the split fraction of a second to look up at the screen, look up at the prism, which is where you can make some commands. You can actually do head gestures, which would be better than hand gestures, but you could do head gestures with glass, and it takes you to another command. But when you go to that other command and you can speak to it and it takes you to another command, it takes a fraction of a second to take that quick glance up. You'll be amazed what happens in that time frame just for that split second, what you don't see on the road. And that goes back to what Ron was saying, you know, talking about hands-free telephone. It takes your mind away from driving, because you can't do two things at one time. You really can't have the mind doing two things at one time.
When I was an instructor at Road Atlanta, I was probably one of the most unpopular ones there with the staff, because I lobbied continually to have the radios taken out of the vehicles that we used for teaching the classes, because I had these teenagers that would come through taking defensive driving courses, and all they wanted to do was play the radio. You know, it's like, you know, you can't play the radio in school. You're not playing the radio here, you know, because like you said, you can't do two things at one time.
I wish they would focus more on what you have on the steering wheel where you can reach with your thumbs, those controls, and make those a lot easier to use, a lot simpler, and where you can control a lot more of what you can do with the equipment on the automobile instead of reaching. Go ahead, Frank.
No, I was saying that's happening now. I was driving, I forget what I had last week, but the point of it was a Honda. And there was not a button on it. You know, when I say that, you know, climate controls, which were under the information screen, they had a couple of, you know, there were a couple of buttons there, but there wasn't a button for, you know, turning up the volume. There wasn't the navigation, none of that. All more and more buttons or controls are being put on the steering wheel. Now, you know, they had a touch screen on that where you could touch this stuff and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, the bottom line of it is I think, anyway, is anything that takes your eye off the road or takes your mind off the road, whether it's a touch screen in terms of navigation screen, audio screen, all that kind of stuff, or the steering wheel, is not good, you know.
Right.
And because even with buttons on the steering wheel, these cars, we don't drive, you know, that long, only a week. But, you know, I wonder how much time would it take you to find this button or that button on the steering wheel by touch.
You know, Frank, you and Valerie came up with 2 points. The lack of actual knobs on the Honda. Everything's buttons and you have to do a touch screen. But also Honda has the dual screen. So now you have to figure out where, because radio and other controls are on both screens. And then they separate. And then they don't separate. It's just throwing more and more confusion for a driver.
And there are some cars out there that they have this information stack. And they, I hate to say this, but one of the guilty parties is the Volt, the previous generation Volt. And it must have 20 or 30 buttons on it. And they're all the same size, and they're all really small. And at night when you're driving the car, the lights are red, and you can't, I mean, you actually have to stare at that to figure out which one you want to push. And it's very, very distracting because it's not like they have different size buttons for different functions. Everything's the same size. And I just found it really distracting. But the ultimate distraction I heard this week is a trucking company was advertising, if you signed up with them, that their package included DirecTV. Now, please, God, tell me they're not watching TV driving an 18-wheeler down the road. Please.
No, it's when they're parking. But not to beat a dead horse on all of this technology. Let's move right along to two, I think, important points, what happened in the industry this year. One is the new sales record of 17.47 new cars sold in the United States, which is a record, and I guess depending upon which company, whether it was that you pay attention to, whether it was 7.47 or 7.5, but anyway, it was a record number in sales. And the other one is, this year is the 75th anniversary of Jeep, and they will be doing a lot of things this year for the different Jeep models. And from what I understand, there will be a 75th edition of Jeep, and I don't know what they're going to include in it. Have anybody heard about what the new 75th edition will be and some of the things that they're going to have on it?
I have not. I vaguely remember them saying something about the Grand Cherokee, so therefore that might be the 75th edition, but what it would include, I don't know. Russ and can confirm or say I'm wrong, but basically 75th editions don't include too much of anything other than a special paint job. You know, it's cost prohibitive to re-engineer the vehicle and actually put something really new in it. So basically, what you're talking about is put all the little doodads on it, give it a special some decals and logos, you know, saying 75th edition, and there you have it.
Well, I'm sure they're going to have it next week at Detroit, so you can give us an update, Frank.
I'll send you a picture.
Yeah.
I've heard rumors that it's going to be a Wrangler and a tribute to the military.
I think it'd be a really neat idea if they paid heritage to the original Jeep and had offered something that was affordable, basically bare bones, and would, as Ron was just saying, it would pay tribute to its original use in the military, something that, you know, younger buyers could afford.
Like they say, the new one is not like your Willy.
Yeah, get my money out of this.
I think that every time I go out and drive my 1946 CJ2, they don't make them like this anymore.
And I'm glad to save my kidneys. Throw you all over the place. Well, next week is the big auto show, the Detroit International Auto Show, and I think we mentioned a few weeks ago before we took our two-week break that some of the manufacturers have chosen not to show up for this year. They're going to use other types of technologies and spend their money in other places to introduce new products. So it's going to be interesting to see how many manufacturers are there, whether they pick up any new ones, or how many they may have actually lost. So Frank can give us another count.
Well, you know, it's worth noting that there's word that Lincoln is actually going to announce that the Continental that they showed in L.A. will actually go into production.
Yeah, they're going to show the production model. I didn't mean to cut you off.
Yeah, and it's interesting because that's a vehicle that's not really meant for the U.S. market. It is meant for China, which is emerging into the largest auto market in the world with 1.3 billion people and a boatload of cars on the road already. So I would not be surprised if some of these manufacturers are holding some of their thunder, so to speak, for the Shanghai or the Beijing shows later in the year, because that's where they're really going to be able to move cars. You know, that's a whole society looking to buy cars now that you've got a huge middle class that's growing by the day.
All right. Valerie wants to know if we have any predictions for the truck and car of the year. What do you think?
I would be surprised if the Titan did not get the truck of the year. I think that's a real game changer this year. So that's where I would bet on the Titan. And as far as car of the year, let's see. We have the Civic, the Malibu, and the MX-5. That MX-5 might have a good chance in my estimation. What do y'all think?
The Titan, I would agree with you on, but I don't know about the MX-5.
No.
I think the MX-5 may have a shot. That car is something else.
I think it has a shot, but the new Civic is a pretty amazing. That's a pretty amazing car, and if I were on the jury, that's probably where I'd be throwing my vote.
It is kind of the car for the masses. I didn't get to go to the launch, so I don't know. I haven't seen it. I haven't driven it, but I'll take your word for it, Russ.
Is the F-150 on that list?
For trucks, let's see. The Pilot, the Titan, and the Volvo XC90. The XC90 might also give the Titan a run for the money, because the XC90 was very impressive.
But the F-150 is not on
there. No F-150s this year.
I thought they would make the list just from that new steering system that they have. If you're towing something, have you all seen that?
Yeah, we've tested it at the rodeo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's something. That's some useful technology there. Useful.
But I think the Titan with its engine, with that new Cummins, that's really a game changer because of it. You know, that fitting right in that middle of a light duty truck and heavy duty, a super duty truck. It's kind of in a sweet spot and also game changer. So we'll see. But that XC90 was also very impressive.
Yeah, Volvo's doing a lot here lately. They've gotten a lot of press, a lot of print. Haven't seen a lot of video of Volvo's, though. A couple of quick commercials, but that's about it.
Their sales last year were up almost 100%.
So they sold 5 cars?
Yeah, I didn't want to say that. I want to stay in good graces with
Volvo. It was more like 80% or 85%, but they went from 5,000 cars to 10,000 cars or something. Yeah. You know, it wasn't a big, if I remember correctly, it wasn't a, you know, big numbers, but it was a big improvement.
I mean, XC90 is going to be hot for them. I wonder if they're going to have the production capabilities to keep up with the demand.
Well, they just opened a plant in South Carolina, so maybe that's one of the things they'll start assembling there.
Well, they're going to have to do something, because if you look at what everybody's saying about the XC90, it's going to be their hottest car. But we're getting close to about at 3:54, and it's quite a few of us in the panel. Why don't we move into our first thoughts car of the day, and let's see, I haven't done a screen share in so long. See if I remember how to do this. Can anybody, everybody see that?
Yep.
This is the 2016 Mazda 3S, a five-door Grand Touring, and I don't know why we're getting a split screen here. It has a 2.5-liter four-cylinder delivering 184 horsepower at 185 pound-feet of torque. Has a six-speed sport mode automatic transmission. The exterior color is a soul red metallic. Interior is almond. It's 27 miles per gallon in the city, 37 miles per gallon on the highway, and 31 combined. This model has an MSRP of $30,270. And we were talking about at the top of the show, the car we had for the week. This little car is outstanding for Mazda. It has, to me, it has a great looks. It has more than enough pickup. Enjoyed using that transmission, the six-speed. The six-speed with the paddle shifters was a lot of fun to drive. I like what they've done with the interior and that almond and black color combination. But this is a hot little car. I think Mazda's going to sell a lot of them. And as we always say, Mazda's one of the best kept secrets out there in the auto industry. First thoughts, Valerie?
Well, I was with you until you mentioned the price tag. That was a little, ooh, $30,000 for this little car would seem like a lot to me. But otherwise, I like the fuel economy. I'm with you on the look, and Mazdas are fun to drive. So I don't know about that price tag, but we'll see.
Russ. You're muted. There you go.
Yeah, I'm good now. I just wanted to clarify the numbers I said on Volvo was for December. They had about an 85% sales increase for December. They're up about 25% for the year. I love this car. It's Mazda just makes some cars that are a blast to drive, and this is one of them. I agree with Valerie. $30,000 is a lot, but I'm, you know, this thing's loaded up, no doubt. And their SkyActiv technology that they have, where they, you know, blend these fuel efficient engines and pull all the weight out of these cars they can, and it gets some great fuel economy. I'm all for it. I like this car.
I apologize for the split screen here. I think it must be the internet connection that's doing that. And that is a high quality video. I think it's shot with 4K, so that may be an issue. What do you think, Ron?
I don't have the split screen on the main screen, but
not a split screen, but it's like a wavy effect.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Mazda has not gotten the credit that they deserve in their design and their engineering. This car, yes, it is up into the $30,000 situation, but it's kind of a special edition with the S model. Mazda's doing some good things, and this is one of the vehicles that should be getting noticed. It's and they've got a lot of fun cars out there too.
Linda.
I agree with just about everything that everyone has said so far. I have not driven this car, but it's a great looking car. The interior looks lovely. Mazdans have long been a well-kept secret in the industry as far as the consumers are concerned. You know, you cannot argue with 37 miles to the gallon highway, and 31 combined is very good also. Little on the, you know, 30,000 might be a stretch for some people, but, you know, it's a very nice package, and I think it'll do well for Mazda. It is great looking, has great curb appeal, so I think they'll go far with this vehicle.
Greg.
Mazda has basically gone to the gym and buffed up with this vehicle. I've driven it. I was very impressed with it. And by the way, Ron, you'll appreciate it. It has a real six-speed transmission, not a CVT. This is a well-built car, well-designed, handles extremely well. And what I liked about it was the fact that for a small engine, it was quiet. It was relatively quiet. It wasn't a buzz box like you'd expect in this size. The $30,000 figure you have to understand this is the top-of-the-line edition with every bell and whistle Mazda has. But it's one of those vehicles. You look at the reliability ratings. These things are reliable as all get-out. So it may become, for lack of a better term, the Mercedes of its generation, because you know it'll start every day and go every day.
Right.
Well, as happy says would have it, I had this car about a month ago. And I agree with everything that was said. I was looking at an article about Mazda, and basically what they're doing is they have excellent product. The design is great. Greg hit something, that I noticed immediately, was that it was a very, very quiet car. You didn't get a lot of buzz from the engine. The president of Mazda was interviewed, I think I saw it in Automotive News, where he said that their number one target is not volume. What they're after is increased transaction prices. So they're making more money on each car they sell. And for those who balk at the $30,000, I can understand that. But I had almost the exact same car, same engine, except it wasn't a sport model. It was all-wheel drive, but it was the touring model. That car was $26,000.
Hmm. Okay, folks, we're at 4:01, a minute over, trying to keep us on a tight schedule. I know you have other things to do. I greatly appreciate all of you taking the time. We actually had a full house today for the first show for 2016. Yay. And we probably won't see this again, so take a screen share of it so that you can have everybody. As a matter of fact, I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna stop this thing if I can, get it off the screen, stop presentation, stop this and get that on there. And I have everybody. I'm gonna do a shift command 3. Everybody
yes,
smile.
Folks,
everybody smile.
Himself.
Everybody smile. Oh, it didn't do it. Okay, what happened? Everybody smile. Hey, come on. It still didn't do it. What's going on here?
Operator here.
Everybody smile. Hey, they did it that time. There we go. I suggest you get a screen share of this, folks, because this will be probably the last time you see all of us. But I wish everybody a very, very happy and prosperous and healthy new year, because as you know, health now is my main concern. I'm sure Frank can testify to that as well.
Absolutely.
And as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next time.
Adios.
Happy New Year, y'all. Bye-bye.
Happy New Year.